The question? The question is, how do you know that God exists?
The learned professor has spoken on this question, why do we believe in God? But I also have been asked by him if I have any arguments on this point. In connection with the existence of God, there are three types of arguments in philosophy: the ontological argument, and the teleological argument, and the cosmological argument. The learned professor has taken the teleological argument, and he has said beautifully, showing the way in connection with God, who is an ultimate value, who is not a thing of this world as we see and observe and know in this world. Of course, about everything which is ultimate, much can be said on both sides. And consequently, there are people who pick up courage to deny and to maintain a stand that there is no God. I would like to take up this thing first. Those who say there is no God, I might point out that no human being has the right to say there is no God. This statement, denial of God in positive terms, is the most irrational, illogical, and baseless the statement which any human being can make. Even those of you who are not students of logic and philosophy can understand it very well. If a person says about a certain thing that that certain thing is not present in this hall, then he will have to prove that he has comprehensive knowledge of this hall. If a person says that there is not a particular thing existent in this hall, then he will have to prove, in order to prove his statement to be valid and true, he will have to prove that he possesses a comprehensive knowledge of every nook and corner of this hall. Without that, he cannot make this statement. If a person says about a certain thing that that thing is found in this hall, the contrary statement, that a certain thing is found in this hall, it is not necessary for that person to know every nook and corner of this hall. It is quite possible that that thing might be lying at the door, and that person comes, just passes by the door, and he sees that thing, and his statement will be accepted as valid. Therefore, anybody who makes a statement there is no God, he will have to prove that he possesses a comprehensive knowledge of all that exists. If he can prove it, then alone he can have the possibility of making this statement. Even then, his statement may be wrong, because there are illusions from which human beings suffer. Therefore, this stand that there is no God, this stand is not possible for any human being on the face of the earth, and it should be completely ruled out. Then we can take the arguments through another channel, which the learned professor took, and I wish to go on the same path and Probably because of time, he did not take it to its final point. There can be two points of view about what exists and about what we experience, about this world. One point of view can be and has been that this world has been created by a supreme being, by God, and it has been created ab novo. The other point of view has been, and it is also put forward nowadays, that this world has not been created by anything known as God or called God. The question arises, if this world has not been created by God, how did this world come into being? Then, as the learned professor said, the only answer will be that this world has come into being by accident. All right. This world has come into being by accident, it means that this world has come into being by chance. Accidental action is chance action. And chance means the absence of law. Therefore, this world in its very origin is without a plan and without a purpose, which means again that this world is a blind world, that this world is a blind process. It also means that because there is no God and material reality is the only reality, therefore everything in this world is only physical or material. And this is the line of argument which the materialists take, because the materialistic metaphysics is wedded to behavioristic or mechanistic psychology. And in mechanistic psychology, they teach us that to talk about the soul, about the existence of the soul, is sure idiosyncrasy. And even to talk about the mind is something nonsensical. Those of you who might have studied psychology know it, that they say that there is no such thing as mind. Of course, soul is not there, and even this mind is not there. There is no such thing as the mind, it is only the brain, which is a sort of physiological, biological mechanism, and it works through itself on the basis of permutation combination. And the brain secretes thought as liver secretes bile. So, on the basis of materialistic philosophy, everything is conceived in physical terms alone. That man is only a physical being. This world is only physical or material. To conceive of the mind existing in this world or even in the human being, and to conceive of anything like spirit, they say this is this ought to be ruled out. All right. Now, if this world is a chance order, because it came into being by chance, then this world is a chance order. What does it mean? It means that everything in this world comes into being by chance, it stays here by chance. The human beings enjoy here by chance, suffer here by chance, die out by chance. And because this world is only physical, there can be no moral bond of unity between different human beings. The moral bond of unity comes only when we postulate a creator and a God who created this world according to a plan and for a particular purpose and created all human beings who are here. It is through God that this moral bond of unity comes in. Otherwise, if this world is a chance order, then every human being comes into this world by chance, and there is absolutely no question of any rational bond of unity between different human beings, except in terms of physical values, and physical values are always based on expediency. Again, if the human being is purely physical, then what should be the ideal of every human being? We know that it is human nature that every human being wants to acquire pleasure and wants to avoid pain. All right. Then if the human being is only a physical being, then the ideal for the human being should be to acquire the maximum amount of physical pleasure, because he is only a physical being. To acquire the maximum amount of physical pleasure would mean to acquire the maximum amount of sensuous pleasure. All right. Now, the principle of fellow feeling or sympathy, about which our learned rabbi was speaking so many times and questions were asked, love thy neighbor as thyself. This principle, which is the highest principle of morals, this principle will fall to the ground. How? Suppose I am a millionaire and there is a fellow being who is a pauper, he is starving, and if I can pay to this person just one rand in order that he may buy food and save his life, then according to this philosophy, it will be an immoral action on my part, because I will deprive myself to the extent of one rand the opportunity of buying physical sensuous pleasure for myself. Then again, if this world is a blind process and it is a chance order, then all attempts by human groups for making plans and making codes of law, whether for the administration of the family or for the administration of a business concern or for the administration of an educational institution or anything else, all this activity of formulating the law would be an unnatural and irrational activity, because it will violate against the very nature of this world. This world being a chance order, it is a lawless world, and there should be no talk of law in this world. Carry it on. The argument runs logically. Of course, you might find that there are groups who say that they believe in materialism and atheism, and they also talk of welfare of the common man and so on and so forth. But there, those principles of welfare for their fellow beings, or their consideration or love for their fellow beings, and their disbelief in God, these are combined on the principle of expediency, not on a rational principle, because they cannot be combined. The only motives that can emerge from the philosophy of denial of God would be two, which are very famous and very well known, but I would repeat them here. The first one is, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, because this world, this human life here, is a bad bargain, and we have to make the best of this bad bargain. The world has no meaning, the life has no meaning absolutely, because meaning comes into life only through belief in God. Without that, there is no meaning. And because on this basis there can be no meaning, therefore the motto can only be this, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. This is number one. And the other one would be, and it is, everyone unto himself, and devil take the hindmost. What claim can another human being have on me? Will not have. The claim comes only when we believe in God, and when we believe that He has created everything abnormal, that He has brought into existence all human beings with a definite plan and for a certain purpose. Then only that sanction comes in, otherwise not. Otherwise it is sheer expediency. And you know, expediency stands on shifting sands. A thing may be expedient for me today, just the opposite will be maybe expedient for me tomorrow. And what is expedient for me at this moment may not be expedient for another person. And unless we know that there can be no human organized society unless there are laws which are universally binding and applicable, otherwise there would be actually no basis for having a sort of social order. Finally, this theory of denial of God, this stand which a person might take that there is no God, the logical consequence would be finally that only the principle of might is right will be the rational principle for the human beings to follow. And the principle of might is right, which in the field of biology, the great founder of this materialistic philosophy, namely Charles Darwin, he has used the words survival of the fittest, of course, in the context of biology. But these same words are to be used in every context on the basis of this materialistic philosophy which says there is no God. Might is right. And might is right, believe in it. And every one of us will be living under the law of the jungle and would like to commit suicide earlier than we might want to die. So, actually, why should we believe in God? If we can think seriously on life, then when we go to bed, we go to 100 cares and anxieties, born of our different associations during the day. Or we go with certain griefs, and when we wake up in the morning, then we wake up with numerous anxieties. We have to accomplish this job today, and we have got to do this, and we have got to meet so-and-so. Is this life worth all this? If this world is just a chance order and I have come into this world just by chance, and I am standing here and I am staying here just by chance, and the life is absolutely a blind process, it has no meaning, is all this worthwhile? Cannot be. The worth in life and the value in life and the meaning in life comes only through believing in God, and consequently we should believe in God. For our safety, for our security, for our happiness, for bringing meaning into our life and the life of our fellow beings.
Thank you, Professor Ansari. Rabbi Lapin would like to answer the same question.
You will notice that we have shifted some way from endeavoring to solve the problems of the world. And I believe that this is all to the good. We are now dealing with a real problem. I find myself in rather a difficult position at this moment. Two speakers have dealt at length with a question that has been asked, and I am expected to find something new and have something new to say. If I may be permitted to do so, I would like to make a further statement with regard to the question. I believe that there is a motivation to that question. And that is, if there is a God, then why hasn't he revealed himself to us in such a way that we have no doubts about believing in him, that he is really there? And to answer that, I come back to my original speech. And I'm just giving you another view of the picture. And that is, we have free determination of will. And if there is no free determination of will, then man is no human being. He is against timeless and boundless. And so the opportunity is given to us to believe and not to believe. And if man achieves the height that he is able to believe, then it is his own achievement. So it is the free determination of will which is given him. And then once again, he is given the opportunity of discovering God for himself. Now, with regard to the question of how do I know there is God, or why do I believe there is God, in addition to what has been said, I just want to point out one thing. Professor Scorry spoke about faith and reason. Reason is most important.
important. But there is also such a thing as faith. Now, I want to say from the very outset that when man has to make up his mind whether he believes in God or not, whether he accepts the existence of God or not, it pains him not to believe in God. From a purely materialistic point of view, one cannot be permissive and believe in God. If one wishes to be permissive, then one can only be permissive if one does not believe in God. So that is one of the reasons for not believing in God. It boils down to the old question. It is really a matter of character. It is a law in the Bible. It is a law in the Bible, and you shall purify yourself before the Lord your God. And purification is a mental state and a spiritual state, not a physical state. It says in the Bible, you shall be holy. And holy is a stage even beyond purification. But those are laws which apply to the individual. And for a belief in God, it is necessary to have purity, and it is necessary to have holiness. And those states can be achieved by the human being himself. But, my friends, there is the question of faith. And please don't misunderstand me. There must be a reason too. But that has been emphasized, and I just wish to mention faith. Once I am fully convinced, logically and philosophically, that there is a God, then it's no longer faith. That's not religion. If once again I may be permitted to give you an example. Music. I don't know how one can explain music philosophically and how one can explain it logically. I cannot do so. But I can certainly enjoy a Beethoven symphony. And I can listen to it being played over and over again. And each time I enjoy it even more. And I cannot explain it logically and philosophically. It is an experience. Religion is an experience too. It is probably the greatest of all experiences. To me, it has been the most exciting experience of all.
There will be only one more question. There's an announcement before the question. Mr. Wajidin Kajika is urgently wanted outside. The last questioner.
I would just like to ask the Rabbi and the professor, if Jesus or Moses, as they say, was Christians or what were they, in other words, and what they came to teach the people, in other words, they come to teach the people what the Jews claim their religion is right and the Christians claim their religion is right. And the Jews, naturally, they claim this is right, but well, to speak openly, both of them condemn one another. Understand? Well, they condemn one another, but in the Injil you find which Moses spoke, and that is the Ten Commandments. And well, they condemn one another, the Christians condemn one another, but in looking the Bible, these words of Moses, and what is he doing there? In other words, Jesus wouldn't let anything happen to the Bible.
Gentlemen, I'm afraid I shall not allow that question. It's not relevant to the topic.
Well, I could ask a question now. I could ask a question.
Ladies and gentlemen, there shall be no more questions for tonight since time is running out. I'm afraid not. We're running behind schedule as it is. And if I do allow you to write, I have four other questions in my head, which I have disallowed. I'm afraid if I do that, I'll have to ask all these questions that are with me. I'm sorry. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you have all enjoyed listening to Professor Ansari, Professor Kamsi, and Rabbi Lapin here tonight, as I've enjoyed it. And I hope that you go away having learned something here tonight. Not to prolong the whole evening session any longer, I would like to call on Mr. Hendricks to pass a vote of thanks to the speaker.
Mr. Chairman, distinguished scholars of religion, members of the Cape Muslim Student Association, fellow students, ladies and gentlemen, there is perhaps tremendous significance in a well-known Sufi saying, which goes like this. The lamps may be different, but the lights are the same. All religions lead to God, and I doubt whether our spiritual needs really differ. Mr. Chairman, I have the privilege, but difficult task, to thank so distinguished scholars of religion, because I know that that is not what these scholars of religion want. Just like the university professor doesn't expect any thanks or gratitude from his students after he had delivered his lectures, but sees the value of his lectures reflected in the examination's results. In the same manner, Professor Ansari, Professor Kamsi, and Rabbi Lapin do not want any praise or thanks showered upon them, but they will judge their contribution to tonight's symposium in the manner you will react against secularism, materialism, and communism, which has given rise to the creed of to the God and soul negation creed, whose lifeblood is the sensate culture. It is not for me to say that religion is the only solution to our problems, although I sincerely believe that Islam is not only the solution to the problems of this, the 20th century, but also to the problems of the centuries yet to come. Likewise, in all sincerity, all of you believe that your religion has a solution to all these problems. We may have our differences, but greater than these is our agreement in worshipping the one true God. Mr. Chairman, there are many people who have been responsible for the success of the symposium, and I would like to thank them on behalf of the association. First of all, the university administration for allowing us to use the premises. Secondly, the Dr. Ansari Reception Committee, especially Mr. Rashid Sayed, whose idea it was to hold a symposium of this nature, and also Mr. Bawa. I would also like to thank Mr. Maki of Maki Publications Durban, who is Dr. Ansari's host in South Africa. I would also like to thank Sayed and Sons for printing all our advertising materials, and Mr. Chairman, I would also like to thank this wonderful audience for their cooperation. And lastly, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for handling the symposium so well, so very well, and thus endorsing the confidence we, your colleagues, had in you. We have acted and had discourse in the spirit of truth, and there's a better understanding. And if we are all in search of the truth, who knows how God may bring us closer together. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.